الزملاء الأعزاء،
dear colleagues,
الحضور الكريم،
ladies and gentlemen,
مشاهدينا الكرام،
dear viewers,
أرحب بكم في هذه الحلقة الخاصة من برنامج حوار العرب والتي تأتيكم من فعاليات الدورة الحادية عشر لمنتدى الإعلام العرب.
Dialogue of the Arabs being held within the framework of the 11th edition of the Arab
العربية
Media Forum.
The title of this session
is News Channels and Arab Revolutions.
لا شك أن القنوات الإخبارية العربية
Arab news channels were taken by surprise.
من سياسيين ومحللين وصناع قرار وزعماء دول. من التسارع في أحداث الثورات العربية والانتقال من دولة إلى أخرى دون سابق انذار،
from one country to the other.
أحيانا
their coverage was a kind of hesitating. Sometimes it was lagging behind. Sometimes it was hasty. And sometimes channels were criticized of being fomenting revolutions, especially when we deal with the Syrian revolution. This accusation was used not only through media on private discussions or in analysis, but the accusation has been used even at the General Assembly of the United Nations. We have followed the UN General Assembly and the speeches or remarks of the Syrian ambassador who called for the end of encouragements or of instigation by many of the TV channels in order to stop such behavior and has been part of the conditions put by the Syrian regime to put an end to the crisis.
Well, really, the
were the Arab channels really instigating a revolution? Have they covered the revolutions with certain agendas that have affected objectivity? What about the impact of Arab news channels on the Arab viewers? These are questions, and there are other questions which we raise in this session to be discussed by our guests,
namely
Mr. Alexander Nazarov, director of the Russia Al-Yom News Channel, Russia, Mr. Nakhli Al-Haj, director of news and Carta Fez Al-Arabi News Channel,
and Mr.
Faris Kouri, detention of BBC Arabic channel. We were expected to have a representative from Al Jazeera News Channel because we cannot really ignore the Al Jazeera News Channel. However, the panelists apologized at the last minute. I would start with Mr. Nakhli Al-Haj first.
السؤال الطبيعي هل تعتقد أن الثورات العربية أصابت Arab القنوات الفضائية في البداية في حالة من التخبط القنوات الإخبارية العربية
في حالة من
التخبط؟ لا شك أن الثورات العربية كانت فرصة كبيرة لصناعة الأخبار بشكل عام
وشكل sources of information to cover events in Tunisia. They were not allowed also during the Egyptian revolution at the beginning to cover the events. News channels were not allowed to broadcast live footage from Egypt, so they resorted to other means. We were not also allowed to operate in Libya during the revolution. And still till now, we as an Arab news channel and even other news channels cannot enter Syria. So definitely these were huge problems, huge difficulties, and definitely Arab news channels, like any other channels, were not really ready, in my view, to deal with major events of this magnitude happening so quickly. So but I believe that Arab news channels did behave very well according to the available means. They even made sacrifices and tried need to report news from their sources, and in many instances they were dealt with badly. They were also used for the sake of misleading by governments, by political parties, by even some news channels. But on the whole, Arab news channels managed to play their role. So, Mr. Nakhat, do you think that at the beginning things were not clear enough? Arab news channels dealt with matters, with events, like anyone could have done. I can recall in Al-Arabiya news channel at the beginning of the Tunisian revolution, we did not know as journalists how to where that revolution would lead. Mr. Alexander, the news channels, why are they created? Are they created to report news? Are they report news in objective way without any biased positions? Is this the main target, the main aim of establishing a news channel? Definitely not. Of course, there are clear targets set for news channels, for our channel Russia Al-Yom, Russia Today. We wanted to report the event, the news of the events, provide also the Arab viewers to learn more about Russia. At the beginning of the Arab Spring, we said that one of our priorities was to convey the official and popular positions of Russia vis-à-vis the Arab Spring. Moreover, we tried also to provide the opportunity for Arab viewers to be aware of the various views that exist about such events, because there was, of course, different views about the events, and we wanted to provide platforms for all major political organizations in Syria and elsewhere to make their voices heard. We are not part of this region, of course, and we do not have any profit that we seek to make through our work. You want to make Arab viewers more aware of the Russian culture, or is it the other way around, to allow Russian viewers to learn more about the Arab world and the events taking place in the Arab world? Definitely, we want to spread knowledge about Russia, about the Muslim communities in Russia, about the foreign policy of Russia, and these are the issues we want to shed light on. But can we say that you want to just convey the official Russian views pertaining to events in the Arab world? Definitely there is a shortage in Russia as to the information or news available about this region. Definitely there are experts who are well aware of the Arab events in the Arab world, but definitely the common Russian viewers are not so aware of such events. That's why one of the targets of Arab news, Arab news channels is to play this role to Mr. Faris. Does this apply to the BBC Arabia, BBC Arabic? Definitely not. The points you mentioned at the beginning of your talk about satellite channels following objectivity and neutrality, this is, in my view, one of the targets of the news channels, but I think we can add also one element, namely to explain what is taking place without taking sides, without adopting a position that opposes another position. As we view the media or information within the BBC that broadcasts in 27 languages, is to try to draw a clear picture for
the viewers and listeners about the events that are taking place that are folding in a true way, trying to really make viewers aware of what is taking
place.
Do you do that based on your viewpoints? No, definitely. We focus on the real viewpoints. We don't have a vision, or we don't follow the official British government stand. Definitely, we don't represent the position of the British government. This is what we strive to achieve since establishment of BBC, and the Arabic language section of the BBC has been airing for 74 years now. So the introduction of Arab viewers with BBC, with other satellite news channels. I would like to direct this question to Mr.
Amr.
The Arab reader, viewer, do you think that he or she wants to have a neutral media of information, or do you think that you want to convey or implement a certain agenda? We have noticed through the social networks that Arab viewers want to express themselves through the various means, and such views may support one view or another without having a middle stance.
Maybe the
reader or viewer prefers neutrality, but we have a multitude of viewers and readers. There are people who seek also to have an opinion. This might apply to those issues that are also controversial, but as to the Arab Spring, there is a question we need to answer, and it has been on for years now, namely, since the Iraqi crisis in 1990. Maybe prior to that, the Arab news channels was single-handed, there was no problem, everybody agreed on the same topic, and there was no problem at that time. But once the huge news channels were created, employing lots of Arabs, there was the main issue, main cause, namely, the Palestinian cause that did not really pose a problem. The West say that the Arab news channels are not objective, but is the West objective in dealing with the Palestinian cause? What I mean is that
المواطن الفلسطيني أنه شهيد.
When we say that we qualify the Palestinian who is killed as being a martyr, the West wonders why we use the word martyr for a dead person.
ولكن حينما جاءت الأزمة العراقية،
but with the Iraqi crisis, the Iraqi working in a news channel has become a player in this cause. This applies also to the start of journalism in 1914.
In 25th
January 2011,
the media were accused of being a puppet of the regime. So
maybe neutrality could be neutrality seen by someone from outside. But I think it is very difficult for the Egyptian journalist, for the Tunisian journalist, for the Libyan journalist to be neutral. Can he or she really be neutral in reporting the news? Can he really give the voice or give the floor or give the possibility for all parties to express themselves? It leads us to maybe
discuss the issue of polarization.
So either you can be
if you can be in the middle, you might be in a gray area. You may be criticized by all sorts. This applies to the editorialists, to journalists working in radio stations and TV stations, regardless of their views. May I ask this question to the audience about the Arab citizen? Does he or she prefer to have a neutral, neutral information, neutral media that can report the news without any opinion? And this may also apply to the new media. What about when the news is accompanied by a view point or by an opinion? I don't know if the mic is ready for the audience to ask questions, please. So please wait for the microphone to be handed out to you. Please introduce yourself. Good morning, Hamad Jahmani. I would like to add that the Arab media is not only really suffering from the Arab Spring. The Arab media have been suffering for a long time. Let's be realistic. Let's face reality. Usually reality is so bitter. It makes you we have the official media, like the Syrian media, media that deal with people as stupid people, and we have another type of media, namely the news channels representing certain parties. Sorry, but my question is, you as a viewer, do you prefer to follow news channels that are neutral 100%, or do you prefer to follow a channel that have agenda? Regardless if you agree with them or not, you may watch a channel which you don't agree with. You just want to get more knowledge or maybe confirm your views. Unfortunately, taking the Arab, the mind of Arabs slightly is the wrong. If the news channel is neutral, you mean aligned with the party? This is clear. Okay, thank you. I just would like to mention here that we have the possibility, the hashtag Al-Arabiya on the Al-Arabiya Facebook page. This is a survey which has been just broadcast, published on our website in order to give the chance to the audience to take part in responding to the various questions. Can you please hand the microphone to the gentleman or to the lady who wishes to ask a question? Abbas Moussaoui from Iraq. I believe the first victims of the Arab Spring are the media. The huge loss incurred by the Arab Street is the polarization of the media outlets to the extent that Arab viewers can see clearly that there are media institutions established that are supporting a certain cause and others are so supporting another cause. So this is a huge loss, in my view, for the Arab media. As to the question pertaining to the Arab viewer, we have really instilled in the viewer all sorts of information, making him or her waiting for a certain types of news. We have focused on ethnic news and so on and so forth. So viewers don't expect us to be neutral. I think news channels need to report news without respecting any agendas, and I believe this is impossible. There is no neutral news channel. Every news channel has its own agenda. If we want our media outlets to be credible, let's be credible and objective without taking into account any benefits or profits. I will allow you to ask two questions at a
of time, but let me go back to the panelists. Mr. Nakhli, the Arab media have been really fighting for years about what to do, really. Sometimes the Arab media are accused of being supporting the regimes, and sometimes are maybe giving to the viewers or readers or listeners what they want. The question is, those who have taken part in Arab Revolution, were they waiting for news channels to leave them, or have they taken to the streets and thus allowing the streets to be the real or real
In certain cases, I cannot believe the credit given to satellite channels that they are the main instigator. I wish we were that powerful and influential as journalists. Our duty is to try to convey or to report on what is happening in the street, in the field, and our measure of success is the rate of viewership. And usually we are deemed to be biased or not. Yes, I think that one of the participants here made a mistake, and he assumed that muhayyad, which means neutral, meant the same thing as being aligned or munhaz in Arabic. So I think that satellite channels were not responsible for what happened. They merely transmitted information. They did not instigate people. They just reported words, instigation words by people. We reported, I don't think that Arab channels made the thugs in Egypt go on camels and hit people in the streets with their swords, or they did not instigate Abu Azizi to set himself on fire, or they did not instigate the tanks to go to Bab Amr. We were reporting on what happened, and we cannot accuse them of being biased. No, they were focusing on certain news more than others. They were having certain guests rather than others. I wish, for example, that the Syrian government would allow Arabia to go into Syrian cities in order to witness what is happening and report on that. I wish the Syrian government would allow more than two people who would be with you, who are with you on Arabia, to talk, because government officials from Syria and Egypt talk to media so that they can really cover both sides of the story, both facets of the story. So when we talk to certain people and we ignore others, it is not because we ignore them. It's because the others are absent. Yeah, I think maybe they do not respond to our calls for them to talk. Since you are talking about instigation, I think that you will stop now to watch a short video of Al-Arabiya, where we were looking for video clips so that it doesn't, we don't give the impression that we are trying to criticize certain channels. So we will see now a video that led to the accusation of Al-Arabiya being instigated. في أذان متابعي الثورات العربية منذ اندلاع نيرانها مطلع العام الماضي. كلمة التحريض لاكتها الألسن في مناسبة وغيرها، ولم يعد يعرف في ظل تكررها من المحرض ومن المحرض ومن المستهدف بالتحريض. فالأنظمة التي تمر بأزمات في الوقت الحالي وعبر وسائل إعلامها باتت تعتبر كل كلمة وكل صورة يبثها إعلام لا يساندها ما هما إلا محض تحريض وتهييج للشارع، ولا أدل على ذلك من إعلام النظام السوري بشقيه العام والخاص الذي دأب صباح مساء على متابعة القنوات الإخبارية العربية وتفنيد ما تبثه من أخبار وتوصيفها بالتضليل الإعلامي،
بل وصل الأمر إلى حد افتراض تصورات مثيرة للسخرية أحيانا.
يبدو أن فقرة الطقس التي تأتينا عادة في أواخر آخر ساعة على العربية بما فيها من نسب رطوبة وعوامل طبيعية متوقعة من قبل هيئات الأرصاد الجوية، يبدو أنها تحولت بالنسبة إلى البعض كما ستشاهدون الآن إلى مركز عمليات يصدر أوامر مشفرة تستهدف الأمن في سوريا. كيف؟ الإجابة في هذا التقرير.
تثبت مدى التزييف والكذب الذي تتبعه هذه الوسائل العاملة على التحريض لسفك مزيد من الدم السوري الغالي،
تحديدا من حمص ومناخيا هذه المرة.
نشرة عن حمص دون غيرها، ودعونا نفترض أنه كلما قيل رطوبة وضباب ومطر وأمطار فالمقصود شيء آخر، ربما سلاح وربما نار.
الأمر لم يتوقف عند هذا الحد، فالبريد الإلكتروني للرئيس السوري بشار الأسد والذي تم اختراقه أخيرا من جهات سورية معارضة أظهر أن هناك من يحاول إقناعه بالأفكار نفسها التي بثها التقرير السابق.
طبعا تابعتم التقرير باختصار، نشرة جوية طبيعية تتحدث عن الرياح والرطوبة نقلت في سوريا حتى أنها في الرسائل المسربة ما بين التي نقلت من الإيميل الخاص بالرئيس الأسد. لينك وصل من القصر إلى بشار الأسد للقول بأنه انظر ماذا كيف العربية تحرض. فارس سوري التعامل مع هذا الموقف كيف ممكن يكون؟ كيف ممكن أن تقول بأنه أنا محطة لا أحرض وأنا لا أريد أن أدافع عن العربية بالمناسبة فقط، يعني حتى أنا لا أحرض لكنها كانت نشرة جوية طبيعية، كيف ممكن أن تقنع هكذا نظام يتعامل بهذه الطريقة بأنك أنت محطة تحاول أن تنقل قدر الإمكان وهو متوفر؟
أعتقد من شأن الفضائية العربية ومنها البيئة العربية أن تقنع أي نظام، شأنها أن تقدم معلومات دقيقة واضحة بشكل موضوعي للمشاهد. لا أعتقد أننا نستهين بعقلية المشاهد إذا قلنا أنه قادر على الفرز بين ما هو واقعي وصحيح وموضوعي وبين ما يزج بمعلومات غير دقيقة. أعتقد أن الناس أقدر على المدى المتوسط والبعيد ربما على المدى القصير يمكن أن يتأثروا بقول هنا أو هناك، لكن على المدى المتوسط والبعيد قادرين على التمييز بين ما هو صحيح وما هو غير صحيح. على هذا أنهم أرغبون
بأن الناس about people. I am talking about regimes which forget or ignore the fact that things are happening on the streets. We had in the General Assembly certain delegates who refused. They were in denial. They refused to realize that things are happening. No, I don't think that this is our mission. Our mission is to talk to our viewers, and the viewers have the possibility to decide what we are doing. So it is not our obligation as a satellite channel to convince any regime. After all, every regime has its own agenda, its own policy, regardless of what news channels say. What about fabrication of news, Mr. Nazarov? Russia and satellite channels in Russia talk about fabrication of news.
مساحتنا الداخلية الروسية.
I think that on the internal scene.
نشرحت محاولات عديدة لفبركة المظاهرات وتقارير
several accusations with regard to fabrication of news pertaining to demonstrations, etc.
But I think
the opportunity is given to the audience to judge by themselves what is happening. Of course, we always have conflicting opinions. Now, with regard to fabrication of news as such or faking certain situations, I think that the television in certain cases can exaggerate a certain phenomenon.
by having around the clock coverage of a certain demonstration, the viewer would think that such a demonstration is going on for 24 hours. So, therefore, I would like to disagree with Mr. Al-Aziz. There is a possibility to have an emotional manipulation of viewers. So I think it is fabrication is there in certain cases, and we should reject it and oppose it. Mr. Khafaji, you said that you prefer, we think that we heard that it is advisable for channels to be neutral, but it is somewhat